Praise the Lord. Oh, that's weak this morning. Praise the Lord. But this is the day that the Lord has made, and as always, we shall rejoice and be glad in it. We're glad to have you worshiping with us this morning on Mother's Day, particularly those who are here with us in person and those who are watching virtually this morning. It is so exciting to know that people of God can gather together to praise Him, for He's done so much for us and He's been so good to us. He woke us up this morning, started us on our way. The rain didn't stop us, and we're going to praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. And in that like manner, you're invited to stand for the opening praise song, join at the choir as we lift up His holy name this morning. You're invited to stand.
To lift our hands and give Him glory. We've come to lift our hands and give Him praise. We've come to lift our hands and give Him glory. We've come to lift our hands and give Him praise.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. The highest praise. Let us continue to worship the Lord in our call to worship together as people of God. Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together.
Sing praises to God. Sing praises unto the Lord.
As thy name, O God, so thy praise reaches to the ends of the earth.
This is God, our God forever and ever. He will be our guide forever.
Before I allow you to be seated, why don't you turn to your neighbor and greet them, and especially if you see a mother, and wish everybody a happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day. Okay, that's enough. There's not. And for those at home, certainly happy Mother's Day. Are you invited to be seated as the choir will continue with a hymn of praise? And after the hymn of praise, Deacon Bill Jones will come to lead us in the morning prayer. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. Good morning. And happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. It may be raining outside, but the sun is shining bright in Covenant this morning. Amen. I'd like to share a few words with you for some things I was able to find describing mothers, if you would bear with me for 1 second. Proverbs 31:28. Her children arise and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Proverbs 31:25. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. Proverbs 31:26. She speaks with wisdom and faithful instruction on her tongue. Proverbs 31:30. Charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. John 16:21. A woman giving birth to a child has pain because her time has come, but when her baby is born, she forgets the anguish. And the great theologian Stephen Morris Wonder puts it this way. She doesn't use her love to make him weak. She uses love to make him strong. Of course, that's Stevie Wonder from That Girl. So, all of these words, I believe, bring to mind characteristics of many of our moms. So I'd like to take a moment to thank all of the mothers and grandmothers of Covenant, and in particular, my wife, for being that girl. Amen. And now a moment in prayer. Father God, we thank you for blessing the womb that birthed us. We thank you for all of the wonderful mothers that you have placed in our lives, both biological and not. We thank you for the mothers that you've blessed us with that are part of Pastor McLaughlin's family. We thank you for Sister Carla and Miss Mary. Lord, we thank you for all of the blessings that we've received through them. We thank you, Lord, for the mothers who are no longer here with us on this earth. We thank you for the time that you allowed us to share with them. And Father God, although this is a day to celebrate the mothers and wives in our lives, it's also a tough day for many whose mothers are with you, Lord. We thank you for comforting those in need today, and we ask that you would place on their heart the good memories and good times shared with their mothers, and may those thoughts and memories bring a smile to their faces today, Lord. Father God, we thank you for all of your grace, mercy, and blessings. And now we pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those that have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. By way of announcements, we just want to bring your attention to our weekly announcement. On Tuesday, we have our evening prayer call at 7 o'clock. You're always invited to join with us on Tuesday evening for prayer, to support those who need prayer and to pray for the church and yourself and everybody else. So join us on our evening prayer line. Amen. That was a weak amen, so I know some of you are not going to call, but let me say it again. Humor me. Let me say it again. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, I know you're all going to call. Thank you. Also, with this morning, on Mother's Day, we are certainly delighted to have a guest preacher this morning. I thought about preaching Mother's Day's message this year. I said, certainly because I'm qualified, because I have a mother. And then the Holy Spirit or somebody slapped me on the head and said, well, you have a mother, but you sure ain't a mother. So I said, well, since you're not a mother, why don't you get somebody else to preach? And I thought of a student that I had when I taught as an adjunct professor briefly at CTS and was an outstanding student in my class. And I thought about her to invite as our morning speaker. And let me tell you something about the Reverend Tina Guynn. She is a woman of God with a passion for God's word and a thirst to proclaim good news to the poor, bind up the brokenhearted, proclaim freedom for the captives, release prisoners from darkness, and to comfort those who mourn. Tina accepted her call to full-time ministry and holds a bachelor in ministry and leadership from Crossroads Bible College and received her Master's of Divinity from Christian Theological Seminary. Tina serves God as a board-certified chaplain with the National On-Demand Spiritual Care Team for Ascension Health, where she addresses the spiritual and emotional needs of patients and staff. She is certified in critical incident stress management and is currently improving patient outcomes through research as a student at Rush University. Tina brings compassion to her ministry by providing quality spiritual care regardless of race, culture, religious faith, or socioeconomic background. She has been highlighted and nationally for successfully executing spiritual care. Tina accepted Christ as a teenager while attending Good Samaritan Baptist Church and was baptized by John T. Highball, who served as pastor. Since 1991, she has been a member of Eastern Star Church and was ordained in 2017 by her pastor, Senior Pastor Jeffrey A. Johnson Jr., and the ordaining council. She serves in various ministries and various leadership roles in both the community and the church. As a Christian, she has a firm belief that all people matter to God and equally share in human dignity and rights. Tina holds discipleship and evangelism as a key component in her ministry as a servant of God. Reverend Tina is a lifelong resident of Indianapolis and the third of four children born to Edward and Helene Matthews Jr. She has been married to her husband, Brian, for 37 years, praise God. And they have two beautiful daughters, Patrice Guynn and Brittany Pulliam. One, all right, Shayla, I'm asking you. One wonderful son-in-law, Nicholas Pulliam, that's Shayla's brother. That's why she's clowning over there. And two precious grandchildren. We're excited to have Reverend Guynn. Why don't you just give her a hand of applause right now before coming? And also, I would be remiss if we did not recognize any visitors who are sharing with us this morning. Any visitors who are sharing with us this morning for the first time, if this is your first time here, could you just stand and wave at us or greet at us or throw something at us? Amen. And then we have some other visitors here who hadn't been here for a while. I won't call their name. But if you look to my left and to your right, that's Miss Bolo. I hadn't seen her in a while, but we won't call some folks' name out. It's so good to see everyone here this morning. It's such a lovely day. Amen. Amen. And now we will have our choir to take us further in praise and worship. And the next voice that you will hear will be that of Reverend Tina Guynn.
Hosanna, our Savior.
No one like our God. Praise his holy name, for he is worthy to be praised. I am so grateful and thankful to be in the house of the Lord. And I'm grateful and thankful for your pastor allowing me this opportunity to come and share a word with you. So I know it's Mother's Day, but can we just bless your pastor on the day? Amen. Praising the Lord for all mothers. Happy Mother's Day. It is time for the word of God. Let us pray. Father, you're gracious and good, mighty and magnificent, and we praise your holy name today. We thank you for women who raised us, who are our mothers in childhood, whether a birth mom, oh God, an adopted mom, an older sister, an aunt, grandmother, stepmother, great-grandmother, or someone else, we thank you, God. For those women who care for us, we pray that our lives may reflect the love they express toward us and the love that you give us. Now it's time to hear a word from you. So please let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, for you are my strength and my redeemer. And may you get all the glory. It's in your matchless and mighty name that I do pray. Amen. Today's message is coming from Luke chapter 1, verses 42 through 45. And if you would please stand and read the scripture right along with me. And exclaim
with a loud cry,
blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. For your hearing, I'm going to say this scripture again in New Living Translation. Elizabeth gave a glad cry and exclaimed to Mary, God has blessed you above all women, and your child is blessed. Why am I so honored that the mother of my Lord should visit me? When I heard your greeting, the baby in my womb jumped for joy. You are blessed because you believed that the Lord would do what he said. Trust and believe. Trust and believe. Trust is defined as an assured reliance on the character, ability, strength, or truth of someone or something. Trust has been defined as something in which confidence is placed. Trust is dependence on something future or contingent. Trust is, in fact, the confident expectation of something, and that is exactly what we have in this text, the confident expectation of something. The story of Elizabeth has a backstory filled with the confident expectation of something. Elizabeth and her husband, Zechariah, came from godly families and were faithful to God. They backed up their outward compliance with an inward obedience, an obedience from the heart. In verse 6 of this same chapter, the scripture tells us they were righteous in God's eyes and careful to obey the Lord's commandments and regulations. Another translation says they were upright in the sight of God. One can conclude that Elizabeth had a reputation of being known as a deeply spiritual woman, a woman who put her trust in God. When we put our trust in God, it does not mean that all things will be peachy-peachy and will become immune to valley experiences. It does not mean that we will not have trials and tribulations. Look at this godly woman. Elizabeth had no children. She was unable to conceive, and being seasoned in age, Elizabeth was well beyond childbearing years. Here we have a woman who lived in a society where value was placed on her ability to have children and on her age. Elizabeth lived in a time where she was stigmatized and endured personal hardship and shame, all because she had no children. I just believe some of us can relate to living in with personal hardship. It is personal hardship when we see mothers working two jobs, sometimes three, just to pay utilities, purchase food, pay for dwelling spaces and places. It can be a personal hardship to live in a time where mothers have no support from the fathers of their children. It can be a personal hardship when freedom does not ring in our lives because our freedoms are restricted due to disparities in healthcare, educational inequality, food deserts in our neighborhoods, and forms of injustice in every 360-degree turn. And like Elizabeth, shame sets in, worry becomes a friend, and stress has the possibility of taking a front seat in our lives. We can relate to Elizabeth because we too live in a society where value is placed on what we have and value is placed on what we look like to others instead of value being placed on who we are as human beings, especially designed by our great God. Elizabeth lived in a time where she was devalued and experienced personal hardships and shame, but she kept her trust in God. She maintained the confident expectation of something. Elizabeth had faith. Let me pause right here just to share that people who have faith utilize prayer. Elizabeth prayed for her child even before conceiving. She talked to God about her child because it's what mothers who have faith do. Our children do not have to be in our sight for us to pray. We do not have to wait for a celebration or a complication in their lives to pray over our children. Our mothers, grandmothers, great-grandmothers, and those who have been motherly have all taken time to pray because prayer is deliberately communicating with God and is one of the most powerful tools at our disposal. Prayer is objectively real. We are talking to a real God. It's real communication, and we're expecting real answers. When we pray for something, we should expect something to happen. When we talk to God, we can expect God to answer. Just remember, God may not answer when you want him to because his timeline does not conform to what we expect. Elizabeth trusted God and held on to the confident expectation of something happening in her situation, and it did. An angel appeared to her husband, Zechariah, and shared the news that Elizabeth, in fact, would become pregnant. Sometimes we can go to God, and God responds to us through someone else. There's a story that you may have heard about a man perched on his rooftop during a flood, praying God would save him. Some people in a rowboat offered him rescue, and he refused, saying that I'm waiting for God to save me. The scenario repeats itself with a motorboat and a helicopter, with this man still stating he is waiting for God to save him. Guess what? He eventually drowns and goes to heaven, where he meets God and complains. That's a whole nother topic. I had faith in you, he said, and you didn't save me. God replies, I sent you a rowboat, a motorboat, and a helicopter. We must be able to hear God when God responds. Elizabeth received secondhand information, but there is no record of her saying, as old as I am, God, you could have gave me a heads up. She didn't say that. We don't see her in this text complaining because her husband received the information first or become irritated. He could not relay what the angel said because he verbally could not speak. What we see is her gratitude to God that her personal hardship was over. We see her thankfulness that her disgrace was removed and God had answered her prayer. And this is the way we should respond when God answers our prayers, with an attitude of gratitude. Any way you choose to bless me, Lord, I'll be satisfied. The road has not been easy, God, but thank you, Lord. We must display some gratitude while going through life, experiencing personal hardship, shame, and when stress takes a front seat in our lives, because our God is in fact a way maker, a miracle worker, and a promise keeper who works all things for good. God is one who works all things for good for those who love him and those who are called according to his purpose. Our gratitude is our response to understanding that God has not given us a burden, that God has not equipped us to carry. So we need to be like Elizabeth and take the posture of gratitude because we must trust God. Elizabeth was a woman who expressed thankfulness, which is rooted in her ability to maintain the confident expectation of something. Her disposition came from trusting God. Simply put, Elizabeth put her trust in God and her prayers were answered, which brings us to our scripture today. In the movie, Waiting to Exhale, the storyline describes the relationship of four women who get together frequently to provide support to one another, nurture one another, and guide one another. They all have common difficulties and rely on one another as they journey to overcome personal hardships and celebrate life. This was basically four sister girls getting together on a regular basis. In this text, we see two women doing the same thing, one of them offering support to another. We have Elizabeth, who was seasoned in age and well into her pregnancy, and her cousin Mary, who was young and recently received news about her pregnancy. An angel had appeared to Mary, sharing she would become pregnant by the Holy Spirit. Stepping out on faith, regardless of the thoughts of others, Mary believed what the angel said and came to the realization that she needed to talk to someone that would listen with understanding. So God, utilizing the angel Gabriel, directed her to Elizabeth. People need people. When God created the world, God chose to be in relationship with humanity. We have to choose to be in relationship with one another because navigating through life alone was not God's intent. We need to lose the generic response of, I'm fine, when someone asks how you're feeling, because the last time I checked, the word fine is not a feeling anyway. Allow God to direct your relationships. Let God tell you who needs nurturing, who needs guidance, who needs support, and who needs prayer. Be open enough to know when you need to be nurtured, guided, supported, and prayed for. The songwriter was right when he said, I need you to survive. You've heard the words. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive. Mothers, find some other mothers to connect with. People, find some other people to connect with. Let God lead you into these supporting relationships. Take an example from Elizabeth and Mary, who had commonalities in their relationship. They were related. Their pregnancies came by angelic announcements. They both were going to give birth, and they both trusted God, and they believed. Connect with some people who trust and believe. As Mary enters the home of Zechariah and Elizabeth, the Bible says Elizabeth's child leaped within her and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Now we need to remember, this is antiquity, ancient times. There were no cell phones, no FaceTime, no text message. Facebook did not exist, so there was no point where Mary could run across and shoot a message to Elizabeth. Google Chat wasn't in place. Zoom wasn't in place. Elizabeth, she did not know about Mary's pregnancy. Yet, the Bible says she breaks out in a glad cry. She becomes first woman recorded in history to worship Jesus because she was filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, I want to pause right here and share about the Holy Spirit. The Holy Trinity is one God in three divine persons, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is God operating in us. The Holy Spirit empowers believers and promotes spiritual growth. I believe the Holy Spirit has the power to convict the heart of unbelievers and shine a light toward God's truth of his word. The Holy Spirit is our guide, helper, comforter, and advocate, and intercedes on our behalf. I agree with my pastor who shared once that the Holy Spirit is an internal compass guiding us toward the S-O-N. Is that not what we have in this text? This woman of God knew her cousin was going to have a child. She knew Mary was carrying the Messiah, because the text says she called her the mother of my Lord. God guided her toward his son, and what an honor it is to be in the presence of the Lord. At times, God will reveal to you what you need to know right when you need to know it. And that is what's happening here. Mary needed to be strengthened. After all, she was a young girl who just saw an angel. She had just been told she would be becoming the mother of Jesus. She could have been overwhelmed even as she believed, and Elizabeth understood this. Elizabeth greeted Mary with joy because that's what happens when you're filled with the Holy Spirit. But not only was Elizabeth filled with joy, her baby jumped for joy. Elizabeth's baby's name was John, who was later known as John the Baptist. Elizabeth was carrying the forerunner for Jesus. And that's a word to all mothers. You never know what you're carrying. Sarah was a mother who waited on God and ultimately had a son named Isaac. He continued the legacy of his father, Abraham. Hagar, Sarah's maidservant, had an encounter with an angel who shared her son Ishmael would have numerous descendants. You never know what you're carrying. Two sisters, Leah and Rachel, had sons which formed the 12 tribes of Israel. You never know what you're carrying. Elizabeth Wharton had a daughter by the name of Ida B. Wells, who was a journalist, an educator, a civil rights leader, and one of the founders of the NAACP. I'm telling you, when you give birth, you never know what God has in store for what you have carried. Ann Durham surely did not know her son Barack Obama was going to be the first Black president. You never know what you're going to give birth to out of what you give birth to. You never know what God's going to do. Elizabeth was carrying the forerunner of Jesus Christ, and the baby jumped with joy on the inside while his mother displayed the joy on the outside. Now, the last verse in this text covers Elizabeth commending Mary for her faith. Verse 45 says, "You are blessed because you believe that the Lord would do what he said." In order to trust, you have to believe. The word believe derives from the Greek word pistuo. Now, that means that you are to have faith in, upon, or with respect to. It also means to trust or to put in trust with. Believing souls are blessed souls. Mary believed the Lord would do what he said he was going to do. And Elizabeth dittoed Mary, gave her kind of a high five, if you will, by applauding her faith. These two mothers stood on the word of God by believing God is able to do anything and everything but fail. All we have to do is trust and believe. God can move the mountains in our lives if we trust and believe. God can break the chains holding us down if we trust and believe. After we've prayed and cried, trust and believe God to respond. In sickness, trust and believe. In a pandemic, trust and believe. When we experience injustice, as we will, we need to trust and believe our God. When our children go left and we need them to go right, trust the word of God and believe it. When we are giving birth to something or someone, trust and believe God has a purpose and a plan. No weapon formed against you will prosper. It will work out because God is able. So just keep trusting. Just keep believing. God will do what he said he will do because he's able. Trust and believe. God will stand by his word, so trust it, believe it, no matter where you are in life, no matter what the circumstance, just trust and believe.
Amen. Wasn't that a powerful word? Amen. Isn't she a great preacher of God? Amen. Isn't it true she's a great preacher of God because she took one course from me at CTS? And that course wasn't on preaching or anything else, but I'm going to take credit for it. We praise God for her power. The message, if you didn't get anything out of that, then you weren't listening. I was truly blessed from the word of God. Thank you. Amen. Praise God. Thank you. Amen. Now, because of her great word, you now have an opportunity to do a great work as well. And that is in our offering. For God loves what kind of giver?
Cheerful.
And aren't we cheerful this morning? And so we thank you for your giving. For those who are watching online, there are three ways that you can give. That you can give online by using our Secure Tithely app, or you can mail your offering to our address that's on the web page, or you can drop by our beautiful edifice on 5640 North Cooper Road, and in the back of the fellowship hall, you can leave your offering there. Please know that your offering is making a difference, it is touching the world, and it is getting God's word out. And so we thank you. And we also, part of an announcement, I ask you to go back, if you have not, listen to the sermon talks. Some of the members of the care partners, the congregation are espousing their view and thoughts, and please support them and share the link. This is how we also grow the church, through digital marketing. And we ask you to share our link with others. We thank you. With your offering in hand, please repeat this prayer together. Victorious Lord, we offer these gifts to be used in the celebration of your steadfast love. We give joyfully so others may join our unending converse of praise. Let all people sing a new song of thanksgiving. That is not merely noise, but is a faithful celebration of your love and grace. Thanks be to God. Amen. Now, please don't get it twisted. We didn't just say a prayer. Please, on your way out, drop your offering in the tithing box. There's alarms on the door. You can't leave until you put your offering in the box. And now, because it is Mother's Day, let me ask my lovely wife to come to give a tribute to our mothers this morning. Why don't you welcome First Lady Carla. You up here. We're recording up here. All women ought to follow their husband. Come on.
The origins of Mother's Day was established by two women, Julia Ward Howe and Anna Jarvis. These women were important to establishing the tradition of Mother's Day in the United States. So in the U.S., the second Sunday in May has been the day mothers have officially been recognized. I dragged it on since Friday, so I've been doing Mother's Day since Friday. And that's what you need to be doing. I stopped cooking on Thursday night. I'll start cooking on Monday morning. In 1908, over 400 women and children attended Andrews Methodist Episcopal Church in Grafton, West Virginia, to recognize mothers. So the church has a rich history of recognizing the contributions of women as mothers. As a woman, we take on different roles and responsibilities, but being a mother has been the most important and the most difficult one, in my opinion. We are responsible for raising, loving, guiding, and nurturing another person. When I think of the enormity of that responsibility, fear and self-doubt creep in. But then I look to the Bible, where I can read about Eve, who was the mother of all, or Anna, who was a mother who taught me that God can heal brokenness, or Hannah, who was a mother who kept her promise, or Ruth, who was a mother that shared her love with her mother-in-law, or Mary, who was Jesus' mother, who was the mother most blessed and honored. Eunice and Lois, who are grandmother and grandmother's team who passed on their faith to their son. To Jochebed, the mother of Moses, who defied the law but had a plan. It is good to be able to turn to the Bible to see how these women in history made a difference in the lives of their children. But I can also look out to the congregation, look at the women in covenant, and see how you are making a living difference in the Bible today. You may not know it, but I see you, I hear you, and I look at each one of you, and I learn from you every single day. I thank you for being strong women and mothers in Christ. Thank you for being a great grandmother, a grandma, a mama, a mom, a sister, an aunt, a cousin, a friend, and all the other roles you play in my life to help me be a strong mother and a strong woman. I thank God for the women who passed on, who are present and also had the privilege of those who have mothered me from above. The flowers in the front are in recognition of those women who have passed on in our lives. I wish I could fill all your dreams and be like Oprah and say, look underneath your seat and see what, and grab something in there. Don't do it. But I can't. And so out there in the narthex is a small token of appreciation. In there are some of my favorite things that I like. And also, there's a scripture reference on the mother that you can take time and look up and see, learn from her. To the men in our lives, I want to thank you for lovingly walk this journey with us and growing with us. And to our kids, we love you and we thank you for loving us back. I am so grateful, incredibly thankful, and unbelievably blessed. Happy Mother's Day to all the women.
And so everyone, I ditto that. I called my congressman, and they're going to change laws, and Mother's Day will not be celebrated for the whole weekend. We're just going to do 1 hour on Sunday going forward, and we can move legislation that Father's Day will be extended for the month of June. Thank you. Again, why don't we give our preacher, Reverend Tina Guynn, a hand of applause for her. And we're going to exit in to give the benediction in the back. And Brandon, you have a song queued up for a tribute to the mothers as we walk to the back, and then as the usher prepare to... what I want to say, direct us out this morning.
Keep it inside. You're the driving.